Right, we're going to talk about rounding numbers in Google Sheets. There's a lot of different things you can mean when you talk about rounding numbers. So we're going to go through the different scenarios so you can understand what you want to do and why you want to do it. When we go into A1 and you look in the formula bar, the actual value is 1.5. So we'll come over here to the right where there's no formatting applied. We'll type 1.5. And let's say you're working in a spreadsheet where you just want to show whole numbers. So what we've done with this number is we've done this the fast way. So we just use this toolbar here, and there's an option on it that says decrease decimal places. So what that doesn't say is actually decrease how many decimal places you see, not actually how many decimal places the number has. So when you click that, it rounds what you're seeing to 2, but doesn't change the underlying number. So when I look in the formula bar here, it's still 1.5. So we'll delete that. We'll come over here to the left. We've done that to these two numbers. So it looks nice and clean, 2 plus 2, right? But when you do any sort of operation on it, when you sum it, multiply it, average it, it actually takes the original values. So in this case, it is 1.5 plus 1.5. So the 3 is right, kind of. But in this case, it's probably not what you wanted to actually do. So if you don't want to just change the way the numbers are displayed, your other option is to change the actual value of the numbers. And this is where some of the different options come in. There's a lot of different ways to do it, depending on what you want to do. But the most common function that's available, and in this case, probably what would make the most sense, is just the round function. So let's take a look at that. We'll go down to this worksheet here, and I will share a link to actually the main page that goes over all of this, and it will have a link to the template. So this is kind of what we're following here. It's on sheetshelp.com. Let's go back to the template though and look at the first example. So we just have some numbers here, 123.45 and 345.67. So those might seem random, but they're just chosen because one will actually round down and one will round up if you follow standard rounding rules. So the standard rounding rules are what we all learned in elementary math class, maybe middle school. And that takes 0 through 4 and rounds it down, right? And 5 through 9 and rounds it up. So if I were to type equals here, and I will type round, and it takes possibly 2 arguments, but the second one's optional. So right now we'll just give it the first argument, which is value. It's just asking for what it's rounding. So we'll say A5, hit enter, and it rounds that down to 123. No big surprises there. We'll take that formula, we'll pull it down, and it rounds the next number up. So a lot of times that's just what you're looking for, right? But that second argument, when I double click in here and I go back and look at the function help, it's called places. And that will determine the accuracy to which you round it, right? How much approximation you're going for. So let's go down to this next example and we'll change that places argument. So we will still do round and we will pick this value 123.45, but we'll say we're going to round it to 3 places. And we'll see what the output is. So the output's kind of interesting. What it did was it output only 2 places. And it did that because there is no third place. So that will become more apparent as we pull this down to the next option. That specified 2 places, and it looks the same because there are only 2 places. You could force it to show it, right? So you could click on the increased decimal places, but that's not the default behavior. So we will, let's look at the other places. Drag this down. And you'll see if you specify nothing, it's like specifying a 0. That's what's going on in row 15. And when you get to the negative places, it will round it to the tens, in this case, hundreds. And if you round it backwards far enough, it can actually turn into 0 because this is not closer to 1,000 than it is to 0. So it rounds it down. All right, so that's the round function, and that's rounding up or down. You do have one other choice, though, for a function that will round up or down. That's called m round. And the other argument that it takes, let me type it out here. It will take the value, but it also needs, so I say needs because that's not in brackets, so you can tell it's not an optional argument. It needs a factor. So the factor is kind of the multiple that we're going to round to. So in this case, it's going to be a nickel, 0.05, right? So we're going to take these prices, we're going to round them to the nearest nickel. And if you looked at $1.21 got rounded down to $1.20, $1.23 got rounded up to $1.25, and $1.25 stayed where it was because it's already divisible by a nickel. All right, so that's M round. But we want to look at this also with changing the factor. So then you really get to see what this can do. I'll drag this down. I'm going to take that currency sign off. All right. Now, if you change the second input, which is called factor, what this is doing, it's probably easiest to visualize if we go to row 15 here, and it's saying, round 111 to the closest multiple of 25, right? So the options would be 25, 50, 75, we'll get to 100, and that's where it rounds it to. All right, and then one little glimpse into something that will be customizable in some of these later functions is rounding negative values. So for now, if you flip both the signs to negative, it rounds the same way, but in a different direction. Okay, so that's the mRound function. And those are the two ways to round up or down. The other two things that you can do is round just up or just down, right? So take all the values and round them up to and do it a certain way. So we'll look at round up. And this kind of works the way you would expect. So we'll just type round up. And then the value, we will give it 123.45. So when we fed this into the round function, it rounded it down, but now it's going to round it up. All right, the second option is places, but it's optional. We will actually not use that. We'll close this off. So that rounds it up to 124. It does the same thing to the next one, although that's what round would have done. But round up ignores standard rounding and just rounds everything up. But it does get a little weird when you round the negative numbers, because which way should you round that? What is up when you're talking about a negative number? So if you use round up, it only goes one direction. We'll round this, and it rounds it away from zero. All right, so if you want to change that, if you want it to go the other direction, let's look at a function called ceiling math. So there is a function also just called ceiling. And that will round up similar to what ceiling math does, but ceiling math and ceiling precise were added to give more flexibility to the ceiling function. I say just use ceiling math because ceiling precise is the same thing with one less argument, right? So you can just do more with ceiling math. If you want to go to the website and look at the ceiling precise function, you can do that. Here it is. It is a little bit more simple. We're just going to look at ceiling math. And it can behave like the round up function at first. So we'll do ceiling.math. We'll grab the number and then we'll round it to, they use the word significance here. I would think it'd be like factor or multiple or something, but they're calling it significance. We're going to round up to the nearest half an hour. So that's pretty clear what it's doing. It takes 120 to 130. It's going to take 130. It's not going to move it at all because it's already round, and 140 goes to 2. All right, but let's look at what this does with different significances. So when I do ceiling.math and I take the value of 111 and I do a significance of 5, it behaves a lot like the round up function. And when you use it with negative numbers, it moves them toward zero. Maybe that's what you want, but if it's not, then you can change the mode. So let's come down to this last example and we'll say ceiling.math. We'll grab the value. They're all negatives now. It's negative significance, but we'll make the mode 0. So that's behaving like it did above, right? So that's going toward 0. But if you change the mode to 1, it starts to move away from 0. Right? So if you're rounding negative numbers, use the ceiling.math function if you want to change how it works. There are other functions that round down, but they're kind of mirror images of the round up functions. So we're going to skip over those, and we will go to two functions that do round down, but they do it in a unique way. So the easiest way to show you the difference between int and trunc is just to look at a web page that compares the two. I'll link to this in the description also. But they behave in a similar way if you just use them in their basic form. So if you just take a number and you run it through the function. But the trunc function allows you to specify a little bit more precision. So there's a places argument that you can use. And they treat negative numbers differently. So it's back to that, do they go away from 0 or towards 0? Now in this next video, we'll go through a Google Sheets add-on where you can give it a column of starting locations and a column of ending locations. Click a button and it will calculate the distance between them. I'll see you in that video. Thanks for watching.